حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله.
Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to him. He born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to him. He born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على نبيه ومصطفى سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. وبعد, dear viewers everywhere, I would like to welcome you to an episode number 169 in the series of Gardens of the Pious. As a matter of fact, since we're approaching the month of Ramadan and it's only a matter of a couple hours before we begin actually the first night of the blessed month of Ramadan, and we give a farewell to the great month of Sha'ban. So we're also still talking about the virtues of upholding the ties of kinship, and that is something which is very essential and important that we have to do prior to the beginning of the month of Ramadan, to reconcile, to uphold the ties of our kinship, to phone our family members if we cannot physically visit them, to reconcile with those whom we have differences or problems with them, whether they are relatives, neighbors, whether they are close or far away. The least you can do is give them a call, drop them a message or an email. This is some of the means of as-sila, of upholding the ties of kinship, so that we begin this blessed month of Ramadan while Allah the Almighty have actually forgiven our sins, and while Allah the Almighty is pleased with us, not while challenging him with disobedience and personal ego, like he's the one who's supposed to call me, he's the one who's supposed to apologize to me, I'm older, I have a greater status, he's wrong and I'm right. All of that, set all of that aside and seize this opportunity. There is only a couple hours left before the actual beginning of the month of Ramadan. I want you to imagine when Allah the Almighty postpones the forgiveness of two who have disputes simply because of their dispute on certain blessed days, whether on the middle of Sha'ban or on Mondays and Thursdays. So Allah the Almighty will postpone their case until yastaliha, until they reconcile. What about while we're approaching the greatest month of the year, the month of forgiveness, the month of as-sila, the month of generosity? So once again, I thought it would be very important to remind my weak self first of all, because if there is anyone who needs a reminder more than others, it is definitely myself, my family members. Then, since I love for you, brothers and sisters, exactly what I love for myself, I want to share with you the virtues of doing this right now. Overcome your personal ego, overcome your personal honor and pride, and pick up the phone and give salam and wish well and congratulate all your family members, including those who are severing their relations with you and those who haven't been talking to you for a while. Say happy and blessed Ramadan to all of us. May Allah bring this blessed month with al-amn wal-iman wa-salamati wal-islam wa-security and faith and peace and total submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a month of forgiveness. We want to be forgiven from all our sins. I'd like to begin with hadith number 322. The hadith in this series is narrated by Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, may Allah be pleased with him and his father. I did not actually choose to begin with this hadith, but what a coincidence. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in this hadith, لَيْسَ الْوَاصِلُ بِالْمُكَافِئِ وَلَكِنَّ الْوَاصِلَ الَّذِي إِذَا قُطِعَتْ رَحِمُهُ وَصَلَهَا. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the hadith which is narrated by Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, the person who perfectly maintains the ties of kinship is not the one who does it because he gets recompensed by his relatives for being kind and good to them, but the one who truly maintains the bonds of kinship is the one who persists in doing so even though the latter has severed the ties of kinship with him. So you can actually say, وَلَكِنَّ الْوَاصِلَ الَّذِي إِذَا قَطَعَتْ رَحِمُهُ وَصَلَهَا. And in this case, قَطَعَتْ رَحِمُهُ refers to the other party, refers to your brothers and sisters, refers to your cousins, refers to your nephews and nieces, all your relatives. When they decide to sever their relations with you, that doesn't justify that you treat them the same. Rather, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the actual silah, the actual virtues of upholding the ties of kinship is not paying them back or treating them with the same, because they sent me a message, so I would reply back with a similar message or one which is better, or I will drop them a call. They visited me when my son graduated, so I will visit them in a similar occasion. No, this is called recompense. You deal with them the same way they deal with you. And eventually, if they are mean or rude to you, you're going to be mean and rude to them as well. The Prophet ﷺ said, this is not the silah. And al-wasil, the person who upholds the ties of his kinship, is not the one who deals with his relatives the same way that they deal with him. Rather, al-wasil, who deserves all the virtues of upholding the ties of kinship, al-wasil, the person whom Allah loves, al-wasil, whom in the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, al-rahim itself asks Allah the Almighty to uphold the one and to connect the one who connects it, and Allah accepted this dua and honored it, is the person whom whenever his rahim, his relatives, sever the relations with him, but he still persists on maintaining their ties. He would not do it once or twice or occasionally just to sign in and out, just to say, oh Allah, I've done my part. But rather, he's the one who will continue persistently to uphold the ties of his kinship despite the fact that they sever the relations with him. I think this hadith answers tons of questions, where if I open the phone line and people start complaining about some of their relatives, aunts, nieces, uncles, brothers and sisters, nephews, that they I'm nice to them and they treat me bad, my in-laws, it would not justify your mistreatment to them. Rather, you should treat them with one which is better. If you wish to be rewarded by Allah the Almighty, take advantage of the approaching of the month of Ramadan. Pick up the phone right now, even if you are watching the program. If you know somebody whom you're not talking to him, or he or she has not been talking to you for a while, this is the right time. Take advantage of this time. Pick up the phone and say, Assalamu alaikum, happy and blessed Ramadan. Alhamdulillah, Allah granted us another wonderful opportunity to witness the blessed month of Ramadan. I wish you a happy Ramadan. May Allah forgive us, all of us, our sins. That's it. This is how we break the ice. And this is a promise that you will feel much better afterward. I swear to Allah, it will not make you feel down, or it will not make you feel inferior. As a matter of fact, wallahi, it is entirely on the contrary, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَمَا زَادَ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا بِعَفْوٍ إِلَّا عِزَّةٍ وَمَنْ تَوَاضَعَ لِلَّهِ رَفَعَهُ. He swears, peace be upon him, that the more you humble yourself, Allah will raise you, will raise your rank into higher levels. Allah will honor you. مَا زَادَ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا بِعَفْوٍ إِلَّا عِزَّةٍ. When you pardon, when you forgive, Allah will honor you. And when you humble yourself, Allah will raise you into higher ranks. And look at this hadith, hadith number 323. Aisha radiallahu anha narrated in this hadith, which is agreed upon its authenticity. It is collected by both al-Bukhari and Muslim, and it is agreed upon its authenticity. Aisha radiallahu anha narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الرحم معلقة بالعرش تقول من وصلني وصله الله ومن قطعني قطعه الله. In this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, الرحم, which is the bond of relationship, is suspending from the throne, hanging from the throne. Again, whether this is a metaphor or Allah the Almighty created al-Rahim in this form and shape where it is actually and physically hanging from the throne, which indicates how near, how close is al-Rahim, the ties of kinship to Allah the Almighty, how much Allah appreciates upholding the ties of kinship, which is Salatul Rahim, to the point that it is attached to the throne of the greatest, of the most beneficent. And it does what? And it says, Ar-Rahim, says, he who keeps good relations with me, Allah, O Allah, keep connection with him. Keep him connected to you. Keep him covered with your mercy. But whosoever severs relations with me, Allah will sever connection with him. There is another hadith in which Allah the Almighty says to Ar-Rahim, responds to Ar-Rahim and says to it, would it not please you to tell you that I shall connect to me those who uphold you, those who take care of their relatives, and wouldn't it please you to sever those who sever you and sever the relations with the relatives? And Ar-Rahim answered in the affirmative. So this is something, it's very simple, but it is very hard. Simple because it would not cost you much. You don't have to pay for it, actually. And it is hard because the resentment and the resistance that is stemming from the personal ego, thinking that you would lose respect, assuming that you would look like inferior or lesser than the other party, dismiss all of those evil thoughts. These are the whispers of a shaitan. Trust rather the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a sound hadith collected by al-Bukhari or Muslim. Ar-Rahim says so. Those who take care of their relatives, those who uphold the ties of their kinship, wasalahu Allah. Allah will connect them. Connect them to whom? Connect them to himself. He has an easy access to Allah. Allah will bless him. Allah will answer his or her dua. Allah will protect them, him or her or them, against calamities via the virtues of Salatul Rahim. وَمَنْ قَطَعَنِي قَطَعَهُ اللَّهُ. And whoever severs relations with me, Allah will sever connection with him. And who can afford that? I want to jump straight ahead to hadith number 325. Hadith number 325 is narrated by Asma, the daughter of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. May Allah be pleased with her and her father. She said, قَدِمْتُ على أمي وقدمت علي أمي وهي مشركة في عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فاستفتيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قلت قدمت علي أمي وهي راغبة أفأصل أمي قال نعم صلي أمك متفق عليه. In this hadith, أسماء رضي الله عنهما, may Allah be pleased with her and her father, said, my mother came to me while she was still a disbeliever. And I asked the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, that my mother, who is still a non-Muslim, has come to visit me, raghibatan, and she's interested in upholding the ties of kinship. She wants to connect me to her. She wants to keep good relations with me. So she asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, shall I maintain relations with her? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, yes, maintain relations with your mother. The hadith, once again, is agreed upon its authenticity, collected by both al-Bukhari and Muslim. The word ta'mi'ah means hoping that we will maintain good relations. The mother came from Mecca to visit Asma, the daughter of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. And this family, is a very blessed family. But Asma, the daughter of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, loved Allah and his messenger, peace be upon them, peace be upon the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, more than she loved her own self or her parents. And that's why she was unsure. Should I treat her kindly? But she's a non-Muslim. What should I do? So she went first to ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that my mother came to visit me. And she's traveling. She came to visit me. Raghibatan. She is interested in, you know, upholding the ties of kinship and keeping good relations with me. What am I supposed to do? A'asiluha? Shall I treat her the same? Shall I accept her? Shall I treat her kindly? Even though she is still a non-Muslim. What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? He answered in the affirmative, because that is mentioned in the Quran. Remember, we discussed the ayat in Surah Luqman. وَإِن جَاهَدَكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِهِ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا وَصَاحِبُهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. Not only that, if one's parents are non-Muslims or non-believers, that he should be kind and dutiful to them, but also if those parents, and there are many of them, many of the reverts of our students, of our friends, who accept Islam, their parents actually exert a tremendous effort and they put a huge pressure on their children to convert them. Sometimes they boycott them. Sometimes they ain't talking to them. Sometimes they even threaten them. There are, you know, very bad cases and situations where the parents really become like enemies to their children when they decide to accept Islam. And this is very weird, especially in the West, because as far as for people and families living in the West, if a girl surprises her family that she is lesbian, or a boy said, I'm gay, I'm homosexual, the parents or the family cannot do much, even if they're conservatives, even if they're church-going people, and they oppose that, but they cannot object to that. By the end, they say, everyone is free to do whatever they want to do. They still hang around with them. And I have seen many families like that, non-Muslims. And they still socialize with them, even sometimes live in the same house, and they accept them. Only when the person declares Islam, even though they improve, they become better, they quit drinking, they quit having illicit relationship, they quit gambling, and they start dealing with their parents in a better way, you know, with respect, with honor. Why? Because this is Islamic instruction, how to deal with the parents. You must be dutiful to them. But some of the parents are stubborn, and they think it's an insult that some of the family members have become a Muslim, and that's a disgrace. It is very unfortunate. In this case, what should a child, the son or the daughter who's grown up, do? Should he say that, well, they are non-believers and they're going to hell, and dumb them and ignore them? La. No. Rather, it is a divine command. وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. Give them a good company. Be dutiful to them. But only in the matters of the dunya, in the worldly matters. واتبع سبيل من أناب إلي. But before that, فلا تطيعهما. Obey them not only in respect of their command to become a disbeliever or to abandon your faith. No, this is not going to happen. My love to Allah and His Messenger, my love to this deen is superior to the love of my parents, my spouse, my children, and including even my own self. But still, fulfill your duty towards them. How beautiful is this Islamic instruction. So when Asma came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, Ya Rasulallah, she came raghibatan, and she wants to keep good relations with me. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Naam sili ummaki. Yes, keep good relations with your mother. Eventually, the mother of Asma, the wife of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, later on accepted Islam. May Allah be pleased with the entire family of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. It was not strange what Asma did, Because on the battle of Badr, on the battle of Badr, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq was next to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, while one of his children, one of his sons, was still an unbeliever, and he came from Mecca joining the Meccan army to fight against Muslims. Later on, Allah guided him, opened his heart to accept faith, and he became Muslim. So he had a chat with his father, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, and he said, "My father, لو رأيتني يوم بدر, you should have seen me on the day of Badr." He said, "What's so special about the day of Badr, the battle of Badr?" He said, "Every time I saw you, I turned away from you. I pretended as if I didn't see you." So Abu Bakr asked his son, "And why did you do that?" He said, "Because I didn't want to kill you. You're my father. I love you." Abu Bakr replied to him saying, "لو رأيتني يوم بدر," you should have seen me on the day of Badr. Why? He said, "I was actually looking for you to kill you, because you came all the way to fight against the Prophet of Allah, the Messenger of Allah. So I was more than ready to take your life because you oppose Allah and His Messenger." So it was not strange for Asma to inquire before receiving her mother or respecting her or, you know, keeping good relations with her, to ask first from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam whether I should do that or not. You give precedence to your faith, to your belief, to the love of Allah and to His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but still, in the matters of the worldly dunya, you still have to fulfill your duty towards the non-believing parents, and non-believing brothers and sisters, and non-believing neighbors and co-workers and classmates. They all have rights upon us. The following hadith is a very interesting hadith, and also we will benefit from this hadith a great deal, since it is the beginning of Ramadan and most people schedule their zakah payment during the month of Ramadan from the beginning. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud's wife, her name was Zainab al-Thaqafiyyah, may Allah be pleased with her, heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was saying, "تصدقنا يا معشر النساء ولو من حليكن." فرجعت إلى عبد الله بن مسعود. زينب الثقفية returned to her husband and she said, "فرجعت إلى عبد الله بن مسعود فقلت له, إنك رجل خفيف ذات اليد." I told him that you're a man whose earning is very limited. And she said it in a nice way, not to hurt his feeling. You're a man who does not possess much. You do not owe any zakah. Rather, you're eligible to receive zakah because he was poor, while Zainab was rich. وَإِنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَدْ أَمَرَنَا بِالصَّدَقَةِ. And the Prophet صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ has commanded us to give in charity. So go and ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam if giving the charity to you would serve the purpose. فَإِنْ كَانَ ذَلِكَ يُجْزِئُ عَنِّي وَإِلَّا صَرَفْتُهَا إِلَى غَيْرِكُمْ. Subhanallah. Ask him if it will be okay, if it will do it, just to give you my due charity. فَقَالَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بَلْ إِتِيهِ أَنْتِ. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was embarrassed. How would I go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and ask for something like that? Rather, you go and inquire by yourself. So she went. She said, فَانْطَلَقْتُ فَإِذَا امْرَأَةٌ مِّنَ الْأَنصَارِ بِبَابِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ حَاجَتِي حَاجَتُهَا. When she went to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, she notes that there was another woman. She had the same mas'ala. She wanted to ask the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم about the same question. So they told Bilal to enter upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to ask the question, and she said, "Do not tell him who we are." Why? She didn't want to embarrass Abdullah ibn Mas'ud because he was one of the closest companions to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He used to enter with him into his house, and he used to have an access to things that none of the other companions would have access to. So she didn't want to embarrass her husband Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and make him feel like that he's accepting the charity from his wife. When Bilal ibn Rabah asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam the question, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, which Zainab it was? He said, it's Zainab asking a question. The Prophet inquired, who's asking? He said, Zainab. He said, which Zainab? Well, remember, Bilal ibn Rabah was asked a favor by Zainab, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud's wife, not to tell the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam who's asking the question, not to embarrass Abdullah. So Bilal ibn Rabah was in a situation where he was stuck. She asked him not to tell her name, and meanwhile the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam asked him, who asked you this question? Who's by the door? And obeying Allah and his messenger should be given the preference. So he said, it is Zainab, the wife of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. May Allah be pleased with all of them. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to tell her that, to tell her and the other woman who had the same question, they will have a double reward, one for maintaining the ties of kinship and another for giving any charity. He said, لهما أجران أجر القرابة وأجر الصدقة متفق عليه. As I said, this is a very important hadith nowadays. Those of you brothers and sisters who know that they have their brothers, their sisters, their nephews, their nieces, their cousins who are desperately in need or in loan, and somebody will be thrown in prison for not paying his or her debt, and somebody's daughter is getting married and he's broke, he cannot afford even to prepare her, and somebody else cannot afford to put his kids in school, and somebody's cousin is in the hospital and they cannot afford the ICU. There are many conditions why look for somebody who's far away, who's not related to you, and give them the charity, the mandatory zakah, including the mandatory zakah, while you already have family members. And guess what? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not just give the answer which Zainab al-Thaqafiyya was waiting for. Rather, he gave an extra answer. He went a mile extra where he said that rather you receive double reward, the reward for giving in a charity, even if it is a mandatory charity, and the reward for upholding the ties of kinship. Even though he's my husband, yes, because supporting the family and paying for the family is not the duty of the wife. Rather, it is the duty of the family father. وَبِمَا أَنْفَقُوا مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ As Allah the Almighty said in the Quran. So since he's broke and he's eligible for zakah, then his wife, who is rich and can afford to pay, and she has to pay to others, she can give him or her brothers or her sisters or her parents the zakah if they are eligible. If they are eligible. With regards to the parents, can I pay zakah to my own parents? I cannot pay zakah to my own parents if they are poor and in need for basic needs, to eat, to drink, to pay for their housing, for their bills and utilities, because covering their expenses is the duty of their children. So if I'm rich enough to pay zakah, then I should cover that from my own wealth, not from the zakah fund. But if the father was in debt, or the mother was in debt for an external reason, not to buy food and drink and to pay their utilities or the rent, then I can settle their debt from my zakah fund. The conclusion, brothers and sisters, giving in a charity to family members and relatives earns double reward. أجر القرابة أجر الصلة وأجر الصدقة. The reward for giving in a charity and the reward for upholding the ties of kinship. We'd like to take a short break and we'll be back inshallah in a couple minutes to resume with a very important issues concerning the reception of the great month of Ramadan. Please stay tuned. رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back. We're counting down. I can say in a few minutes inshallah we will witness the visit of the honorable guest, the month of Ramadan. So are you ready? Let me remind you first with our phone numbers, because we're going to be talking about a very important issue, inshallah, concerning what to do next. We'll be more than happy to take your phone calls and answer your questions and concerns, inshallah, over the next few minutes before we begin the month of Ramadan. Our phone numbers beginning with area code are 002-0238-555-249. Alternatively, area code 002-011-250-8679. And the email address is gardens@huda.tv. The Facebook page is Dr. Muhammad Salah Official. In a few minutes, inshallah, Azza wa Jal, in most countries, the month of Ramadan will begin. It has already begun in some countries, like in Egypt. A few minutes ago, the night has entered, and we had said goodbye to the month of Sha'ban. We're officially now in the month of Ramadan, because once the sun sets on the last day of the month of Sha'ban, that is the beginning of the month of Ramadan. But we're going to be fasting tomorrow. That is right. But the Taraweeh begins tonight, because the night precedes the day. So all the Sha'air of Ramadan begin from the night that precedes the day. I mean that those who are going to perform Umrah, if they make the intention of Ihram after sunset on the last day of Sha'ban, guess what? Their Umrah is worth Hajj. Not just a Hajj, Hajj with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَإِذَا كَانَ رَمَضَانَ فَاعْتَمِرِ فَإِنَّ عُمْرَةً فِي رَمَضَانَ تَعْدِلُ حَجَّةً. In another narration, فَإِنَّ عُمْرَةً فِي رَمَضَانَ تَعْدِلُ حَجَّةً مَعِي. Whenever it is the month of Ramadan, he said to one of his companions who did not perform Hajj, she did not have an available ride, he said, don't feel sad. In Ramadan, you can perform Umrah, because performing Umrah in Ramadan will be equivalent or reward to performing Hajj along with me. Performing Hajj along with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So those who said the Talbiyah, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik, after sunset on the last day of Sha'ban, this is a Umrah that is done during the month of Ramadan. So congratulations. I'm saying that because inshallah, in a few minutes, when the Isha prayer will be called upon and people will go for the first time, many people did not attend the prayer in congregation. And since last Ramadan, masajid, plural of masjid, were not as full as of today, tonight, on the Isha prayer, where you will see in the first couple nights, masajid are full. So those who will go late would not find room. They may end up praying outside the masjid. Why? Because this is the human nature. They get excited, especially with the beginning of the month of Ramadan because of its virtues, and they attend the Isha and they attend the Taraweeh. Then many people slow down until it is the last one third of Ramadan, and particularly the odd nights, the masajid will be full once again. The true believers, those who deal with Allah the Almighty, do not behave like that. Rather, since the beginning of the month of Ramadan, they prepare themselves for the hard work. Why Taraweeh? What is the meaning of the word Taraweeh? Taraweeh is plural of Tarweeha. And the word Tarweeha means to take a break. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pray the night prayer as he prescribed, two by two. They would pray two, then two, then they would take a break before they resume praying two by two. Why take a break? Because their prayer of the night prayer was very long. Long standing, long recitation, long ruku', long sujood. So they would take a break after offering four rak'ahs. So that is called tarweeha. And then they call the whole prayer taraweeha, because of the habit of taking a break in between. Why do we pray taraweeha and only in Ramadan? Due to a hadith which is collected by Imam al-Bukhari Muslim, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. He who stands up in prayer during the nights of Ramadan, fulfilling two conditions, إيمانا واحتسابا, all his sins will be forgiven. All their sins will be forgiven. So what are the two conditions? Imanan wa ihtisaba. out of faith. I'm doing this because I believe in Allah. I am complying with the instructions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. واحتساباً anticipating the reward. Which reward? Forgiveness. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith. Subhanallah, nowadays there are people who attend the Taraweeh. Some people attend to steal shoes. Some people attend to report names to the authorities. Across the Muslim world, a lot of security agencies spread their guys to record the names of those who pray so that they, you know, have files for them. Those people will be deprived from any reward. They are traitors. But imanan wahtisaba, he who prays Taraweeh or night prayer in Ramadan, imanan wahtisaban, all their previous sins will be forgiven. But didn't you notice that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, man qama ramadana? Doesn't this mean to pray for the whole night while the Taraweeh is an hour more or less? In some places it is several hours, and in some places they pray with one para, sometimes half para, sometimes short surahs. Guess what? If you join the imam in praying Taraweeh until the imam wraps it up and finishes, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the Sahih hadith, which is collected by Imam al-Tirmidhi in his Sunan, and Sheikh al-Albani, may Allah have mercy on him, judged the hadith as a sound hadith, من صلى مع إمامه حتى ينصرف كتب له قيام ليلة. He who attends the night prayer with the Imam until the Imam finishes the prayer, Allah will record this prayer for him, and the reward for this prayer similar to the reward of praying for the entire night, for the whole night. The night begins from sunset, ends at dawn. So this is a long time, 8 hours more or less depending on where you are. If you attend the prayer of Taraweeh with the Imam until he finishes, then you will receive the reward of praying for the whole night. That is something not to be missed, inshallah. Sometimes, if the person wasn't able to attend the Taraweeh in the masjid, or a lot of people due to night shift, they will not be able to pray the Taraweeh on time, make it up. You have a long way until dawn. Because in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when somebody asked him, how am I supposed to pray the night prayer? He said, صَلَاتُ اللَّيْلِ مَثْنَى مَثْنَى فَإِذَا خِفْتَ الْفَجْرَ فَأَوْتِرْ بِوَحِدَى. The night prayer is 2 by 2. And if you fear the approaching or of the daybreak or dawn or fajr, then pray the witr, even one rak'ah. So this hadith have multiple benefits. Number one, it taught us how to pray the night prayer. It should be 2 by 2. Number two, it taught us that the night prayer should be wrapped up and the last prayer at night should be witr, which means odd rak'ah, 1 or 3 or 5, not even. Number four, that it is extended until the daybreak, until the dawn, until the adhan of fajr. And you can pray any part of the night. You postpone some of the prayer. You can pray some early and some later. You can pray with the imam. Then you can continue at home. All of that will benefit from this hadith. Why should we pray in the masjid Taraweeh? Whatever applies to the fard applies to the nafila with regards to the Taraweeh. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam prescribed the Taraweeh prayer or the night prayer in Ramadan in the first 3 nights that he used to lead them in the prayer. And after a couple nights, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saw the masjid was full, he started praying on his own at home, and the companions, each one would pray at home. Why? Aisha radiyallahu anha narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to give up or used to interrupt some good deeds that he would love to do, but he would slow down or interrupt them deliberately, خَشْيَةَ أَنْ يُفْرَضَ عَلَىٰ أَصْحَابِهِ. The hadith says, إِنْ كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَيَدَعُ الْعَمَلَ وَهُوَ يُحِبُّهُ خَشْيَةَ أَنْ يُفْرَضَ عَلَىٰ أَصْحَابِهِ. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were very keen to imitate him in every act that he would do, even if he did not instruct them that this act is fard or recommended or mean nafl. They would just do it. So when they saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam praying taraweeh and they joined, many acts of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would interrupt them, lest his companions may assume that it's fard. And if they assume it is fard, it will be a burden for many people who cannot afford to do it. So sometimes he would interrupt some nawafil deliberately so that the companions would observe that it is not mandatory. Like the witr prayer, for instance. Like the nawafil before and after the prayer. But when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, and then Umar ibn Khattab became the second caliph after Abu Bakr Siddiq, when he entered the masjid and he saw the companions were praying either individually or in small groups, the taraweeh, he thought of gathering all of them and assembling them behind one imam, Ubay ibn Ka'b. Why? Because that is something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have done. It is not something new. And now since the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away and it was acknowledged and it is confirmed that the night prayer is mere nafila, voluntary prayer, and it's not mandatory, so there is no fear if we pray it in congregation. And they have been doing this ever since Umar ibn Khattab assembled the companions in the masjid with an agreement and a general consensus of all the companions. Initially, they used to pray 8 rak'ahs. In the hadith, Aisha radiallahu anha narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never prayed more than 11 rak'ahs on every night. In another narration, 13 rak'ahs. 8 rak'ahs, 2 by 2, then the witr, 3 rak'ahs. Umar ibn Khattab in the beginning did that. And there are authentic narrations that the companions also prayed the night prayer 23 rak'ahs. Why? Remember the earlier hadith in which I said that a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him about the night prayer. He said, Salatul Layli Masna Masna 2 by 2. That explains it all. He said so to this companion even though he used to pray 8. But wait a minute. The Prophet's prayer was pretty long, that when Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman prayed behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once, he saw him praying the night prayer, so he joined him. And when he started the recitation of Surah Al-Baqarah, he said, probably he would only read 100 ayah, then he would make ruku'ah. 100 ayah is plenty. But rather he finished Surah Al-Baqarah. And he assumed that when he finishes Surah Al-Baqarah, he would make ruku'ah. Rather, he started the following surah back then was Surah An-Nisa, then Al-Imran. Then, so Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman was about to leave the prayer. He could not afford it. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not begin the prayer as an imam. He was praying by himself, and this is voluntary prayer. So if you guys pray long prayer and you want just to keep it 8 rak'ahs, that's perfectly fine. Breaking down the number of rak'ahs, increasing the ruku', increasing the sujood, it gives a break and it makes it lighter for people, especially those who cannot afford to stand for 10 minutes or 15 minutes or 20 minutes to read kabur ruba', so that they finish the one para every night. It is perfectly fine to finish the Quran in Ramadan or in the first half of Ramadan or to finish it twice in Ramadan. There is no restrictions, nor there is a certain limit. But since Ramadan is the month of the Quran, increase as much as you can afford of its recitation within your capacity in the prayer, before the prayer, outside the prayer, as much as you can. So if you are blessed enough to perform Umrah and you join the Imam in the Haram and they are praying 20 plus rak'ahs, pray with them. Why waste the reward? Some people say, I would only pray 8. Okay, you get the reward of 8. And they don't pray anything else. So they travel all the way to do ibadah and they just pray the 8 rak'ahs. What they are missing? Number one, the hadith which says, whoever prays with his imam until he finishes, it will be written for him as if he's been standing up in prayer for the whole night. He doesn't get this reward. Number two, he missed the reward of attending the prayer and listening to the recitation, the rest of number of rak'ahs, and the rest of the one para of the Qur'an. Sometimes when we enter the masjid, some people come late and they have not prayed Isha, and there is a prayer going on. The imam is leading Taraweeh. It is not required to have the same intention of the imam in the prayer. What does it mean? It means you can join the imam who's leading the Taraweeh prayer Nafila while your intention is to pray Isha, but who is only praying two rak'ahs, two by two, and Isha is four, perfectly fine. You can pray the two rak'ahs on your own after he makes taslim with comfort, then you join the imam in the rest of the Taraweeh. Brothers and sisters, do not waste this magnificent word. Begin tonight, inshallah azza jal. Happy and blessed Ramadan to all of you. Include the whole ummah in your dua, your family members, your parents, your brothers and sisters, our brothers and sisters, the Rohingya brothers and sisters in Burma, Myanmar, the Palestinians, the Syrians, the Egyptians, the Iraqis, the people in Pakistan, the Yemenis, the whole Muslim ummah. A dua is the sharpest weapon of the believer. Allah the Almighty says, "Ud'uni astajib lakum." And the ayat of the dua were mentioned in the middle of the course of talking about fasting and the blessed month of Ramadan. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانَ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. May Allah accept from all of us. Happy Ramadan to all of you. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. So why did they ignore that, forgetting all about it in paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price? So why did they ignore that, forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling their best with the cheapest price?